Jeffrey Dahmer. Jeffrey Dahmer was born in Milwaukee. His father, Lionel Dahmer, was a chemistry student at Marquette University when he married Joyce Flint in 1958. Jeffrey was born 2 years later. 2 years later still, Lionel completed his master's degree and transferred to the University of Iowa to work for his doctorate. He completed the doctoral program in 1966, moved to the Cleveland-Akron conurbation in Ohio, where he found a good job as an industrial chemist and saw Joyce give birth to their second child, David. The birth was difficult, as was the marriage. Lionel and Joyce fought obsessively for the next 12 years. Jeffrey was a background figure in his own home, where his parents' attention was fixed on their personal strife. Neither was deliberately cruel to their son. He was not beaten or abused. He was just emotionally neglected, overlooked in the storms of rage and hatred that flowed around him and over his head. The malign neglect was not deliberate, but children need attention to form their personalities, just as they need food and sleep to form their bodies. Jeffrey just didn't get it. Extraordinary aspects of his personality developed when he reached high school age. Friends were astonished and mildly impressed by the schoolboy who kept bottles of beer and spirits in his locker, who had an old army jacket with panels to hold small bottles in the lining so that he needn't leave the classroom when he wanted a nip. He desperately wanted attention, and he got drunk repeatedly and behaved in extravagant ways to ensure it. One of his habits was truly ominous. He developed an obsession with dead creatures. He took to collecting small rodents, groundhogs and squirrels run over by cars. He would bring his roadkill back, dissect them, preserve them, boil off the flesh to retain the skeletons. He collected chemicals which he hoped would prove preservative. And he created a little cemetery of animal remains with tiny skulls on twig crosses. Most of his friends were disgusted when he suggested that they join him in hunting roadkills. As he reached the end of his high school career, the emotional neglect he suffered reached a climax. The yearbook photographs show that he was not physically neglected. He was well-dressed, wore good wire-rimmed designer spectacles, and his long, silky mid-brown hair was beautifully clean and kempt. But at home, he suffered psychological chaos. His parents' quarrels could be heard by the neighbours, until at last Dr. Dahmer moved out to a hotel, and the Dahmers embarked on what were to be long and acrimonious divorce proceedings. The care of young David was a matter for their wrangling. The two accused each other of being unfit to have custody of the boy. But Jeffrey was 18, and so in the court's eyes he was an adult who was not their official concern. At the age of 18, Jeffrey Dahmer suddenly found himself left alone in a family house from which his parents had separately removed the furniture and his younger brother and themselves. He had no money, little food, just a car and a wonky refrigerator with which to care for himself. Neither Lionel nor Joyce was deliberately cruel. They were just obsessed with their own quarrel. On June the 4th, 1978, Jeffrey Dahmer graduated from high school. 2 weeks later, he committed his first murder. Stephen Hicks was Jeff's age. On June the 18th, he hitched from his home at Coventry, Ohio, to a rock concert at Chippewa Park. After the concert, he started hitching back home. Jeff Dahmer picked him up and invited him to the deserted family home for a few beers. Hicks accepted and then, after some drinks, said he was ready to leave. Something snapped in Jeffrey Dahmer. He'd been abandoned by his family. His high school days had ended with whatever companionship that offered. He could not take what felt like instant abandonment by a stranger. He smashed Hicks over the head with a barbell and then used its handle to throttle him to death. I won't deny it. I feel sorry for the 18-year-old murderer Jeffrey Dahmer, though I feel even sorrier for the innocent rock fan Steve Hicks, who found unexpected death. Better for everyone if Dahmer had been caught immediately. Alas, he took elaborate precautions to make sure he was not. He hid the body in a crawl space between the family home's basement and foundations. He cut it up and stripped off skin, muscle and tendons to dissolve them in acid. He took the skeleton and smashed it into thousands of tiny fragments with a sledgehammer. He buried the viscous remains widespread around his garden. When he confessed to the crime 13 years later, the only physical evidence left was chemically detectable bloody handprints and bloodstains on the cinder blocks of the crawl space. From school and murder, Dahmer went on to college. He managed one semester at Ohio State University, where contemporaries remembered him as a really serious drinker. When he left college with no valuable grades, he tried to reform by enlisting in the army. He served for a period in Germany, but before he'd completed his contracted tour of duty, he was dishonourably discharged for habitual drunkenness. This was a young man who'd failed at everything except his murder. Back in America, he went to work in a sandwich shop in Florida. After 6 months, he went back to rejoin his father in Ohio, and here he started to amass a police record for petty offences: drinking, drunken brawls, mooning, flashing. He was a squalid, drunken, trivial offender. Dr. Dahmer decided that the one person who seemed to offer the boy the love and attention he needed was Jeff's grandmother, Catherine Dahmer. Jeff was sent to live with her in the upmarket suburb of West Allis, Milwaukee. He worked at a blood plasma centre, then for a chocolate company. He was a low-grade, unskilled worker, usually on the graveyard shift. And he discovered the anonymous gay bars of the big city. There he got drunk and picked up one-night stands and took them back to his grandmother's. He was banned from one gay bathhouse for slipping drugs into the drinks of his companions. Ultimately, Catherine Dahmer was disturbed by his tendency to disappear into her basement with some male stranger and refused to let her in. She was aware that they were undressed. But before her disturbance reached the point that she had to insist that Jeff leave, he had killed again. In November 1987, Dahmer went to the Ambassador Hotel with 24-year-old Stephen Tuomi. They drank till they passed out. When Dahmer came round, Tuomi was dead, with blood oozing from his mouth. Dahmer said he didn't know how he did that, though he agreed that he pretty certainly did it. Anyway, he took the body home in a large suitcase to cut it up and dispose of it. He also fried and ate one of Tuomi's biceps. In January 1988, Dahmer picked up a 14-year-old Amerindian rent boy called James Dockstater. He killed him in Catherine Dahmer's basement and completely obliterated the body with acid and a sledgehammer, as he had Steve Hicks's. In March, he picked up Richard Guerrero at a gay bar, took him home and killed him. But Catherine Dahmer started to object to the increasingly smelly rubbish Jeff was putting out in garbage bags. When Lionel questioned his son, Jeff came up with a plausible story about dead fish from his aquarium collection. Still, he was outstaying his welcome, even with his affectionate grandmother. Jeff Dahmer moved out into an apartment of his own, and with this total independence, he committed the crimes that would bring him instant and lasting infamy. The day he moved in, he saw a young Asian boy walking home from school. Dahmer asked the lad if he'd like to earn some money by posing to have his picture taken. The boy willingly agreed and accepted a cup of coffee from the soft-spoken, sandy-haired man back at his apartment. He was the 13-year-old son of Laotian refugees Sunthomi and Somdi Sinthansomphone. The coffee he drank was drugged, and soon young Sinthasomphone was unable to resist when Dahmer removed his pants, fondled his genitals, and photographed him in that state. But he came to and made his way woozily out of the flat. Looking drunk on the street, he was taken to hospital. Dahmer was arrested and charged with sexual assault and enticing a minor for immoral purposes. These were the first serious charges he'd faced. In January 1989, he was convicted. Sentencing was postponed for 2 months while prosecution and defence prepared their differing proposals, and during this interval, Dahmer killed again. He met 26-year-old Anthony Sears at a gay bar called La Cage, invited him home for a drink, drugged him and strangled him. He boiled the flesh off his skull and painted the skull grey to start a new macabre collection. And with that safely behind him, he reported back to court, smoothly assuring the judge that the seduction of young Cynthia Somphone was his first serious offence. It had been entirely the result of alcohol. He couldn't understand what had come over him. He'd never do it again. But the judge sentenced him to 10 years, allowing, however, 1 year first in a house of correction, which permitted him to go out to his job. If he did that satisfactorily, the 10 years might be set aside. Dharma was a model prisoner. He was paroled after 10 months. In May 1990, he took a one-room flat in the distinctly downmarket Oxford Apartments. He was almost the only white resident in the building, and he swiftly made his apartment the smelliest, despite frequent complaints from neighbours and the building manager. Dharma made smooth apologies about meat having gone off in his freezer. Nobody imagined for one moment that he'd strangled and chopped up 26-year-old Ray Smith on May the 29th, 29-year-old turban-sporting Eddie Smith on June the 14th, 29-year-old Ernest Miller on September the 2nd, heterosexual David Thomas, apparently picked up in error, on September the 4th. Skulls, bones and other body parts of Ray Smith and Ernie Miller were retained and preserved, giving Dharma's flat its vile stench. There was a six-month lull. Then in March, Dharma began his last self-destructive stampede of assassination. Eyelash-batting pretty boy, 18-year-old Curtis Strauter, was killed sometime in March. 19-year-old Errol Lindsay died on the 7th of April. Anthony Hughes, a sweet-natured 31-year-old deaf-mute, was killed on May the 24th. And 2 days later, Dharma made the pickup that brought him and the police joint notoriety. By an astonishing coincidence, the 14-year-old Laotian youth he lured off the pavement was Konarek Cyntha Somphone, younger brother of his former molestation victim. Like his brother, Konarek wandered woozily out onto the street, but he was half-dressed and bleeding from the buttocks. Three deeply concerned and responsible black ladies called the police and were appalled when the cops accepted Dharma's claim that the lad was 19, although he looked younger, and he was drunk, and he was Dharma's habitual sadomasochistic lover. The cops let Konarek go back to Oxford Apartments with Dharma, who killed him that night, cut him up, and added the parts to his collection. On June the 30th, Dharma picked up 20-year-old Matthew Turner at a gay pride march in Chicago. He persuaded him to come back to Milwaukee, strangled him, beheaded him, and dumped his torso in a 57-gallon barrel he'd bought. On July the 5th, Dharma was in Chicago again. He picked up Jeremiah Weinberger at a gay dance club, took him back to Milwaukee, and treated him as he had Turner. 23-year-old Oliver Lacey was picked up on the street as he was going to buy ice cream. His head ended up in Dharma's fridge. His heart was in the freezer because, Dharma said, he intended to eat it later. On July the 19th, a married but apparently bisexual man named Joseph Braderhoft became Dharma's last victim. He was in Milwaukee looking for a job when he had the misfortune to meet Dharma and accept his invitation back home for a drink. 3 days later, the horrendous career of murder came to an end. As had happened with David Thomas, Dharma made the mistake of picking up a heterosexual. 32-year-old Tracy Edwards was staying with his brother in Dharma's neighbourhood and had often seen Jeff around. On the evening of July the 23rd, Edwards and Dharma agreed that they were going to take some drinks over to some other people's place for an impromptu party. On the way, Dharma suggested they drop in at his flat for a drink. Edwards agreed, tolerating the abominable stink in which Jeff lived, because he accepted his host's explanation that it was sewers and he only expected to stay for one drink anyway. He stayed for 4 terrifying hours. As it began to occur to him that his beer tasted odd and he wondered whether it had been spiked, Edwards saw Dharma leap at him with a knife and a pair of handcuffs, snapping a cuff quickly on his left wrist. Tracy Edwards tried to play along with this wild man, who threatened to ravish him, kill him, and cut him up. He unbuttoned his shirt, pretending agreement to the idea of a pornographic photography session. He talked incessantly, he made visits to the bathroom, and all the time he studied the door locks, until at 11 p.m. Dharma's attention flickered and his chance came. Tracy Edwards smashed a karate chop at his captor and hurtled through the door. Dharma caught his arm and promised he'd take the handcuff off if he'd come back inside. Edwards wrenched himself free and raced onto the street, bawling for help. Cop cars don't ignore the incident if they see a running 11-stone black man with handcuffs dangling from his wrist. Tracy Edwards immediately found uniformed, if rather suspicious, help, and soon he was leading officers Routh and Mueller into the smelly flat, dominated by its fish tank, gay pin-ups and porno pictures. Asked why he'd threatened Edwards, Dharma tried a plausible line of defence.
I just lost my job and I wanted to drink some beer, he growled.
The bad-tempered drunken loner, down on his luck and being quarrelsome, might just have worked as a pose. But the strain was too much. Dharma suddenly threw a fit of raving mania. Neighbours heard him screech eerily, and then a fight started, with the cops and Edward saying things like, "You faggot! Oh, the son of a bitch just scratched me! Oh, God, he's going in one of those homo modes again!" And it ended with Dharma flattened on the floor and held down, while the cops started to hear Edward's story with a new belief. When Dharma was securely manacled and fettered, the cops started to search his flat, and the minute they opened the fridge and found Oliver Reaver's head, the chain of discoveries began, which made this man a classic murderer even before he came to trial. Dharma confessed to all his murders, including those which were totally unsuspected and from which no identifiable body parts remained. He went on trial in due course. He was convicted inevitably, and he died in prison before the end of the century.